So now it's my pleasure to introduce the master of ceremonies for this event, Professor Heureux Lewis McCoy. And Professor Lewis McCoy is an associate professor of sociology and black studies. His research concentrates on the issues of educational inequality, the role of race in contemporary society, and gender equity. Professor Lewis McCoy is also a public scholar whose commentary can be found on media in media outlets such as U.S. World News Report, National Public Radio, Ebony, TheRoot.com, and TheGrio.com. His recent book, Inequality in the Promised Land, is a study in the discrimination of black students and families in suburban America. He is also, I would say, you know, one of our more engaged faculty members with the students. And he's the founder and facilitator of the Ndugu and Zinga Rites of Passage ceremony at the school. And I think there are quite a few of the students who can kind of attest to his being an amazing mentor and guide in their time at CCNY. Hopefully it's only 4 years. All right, Professor Lewis McCoy.
Thank you, Professor Serling, for that opening. It is my responsibility and opportunity to moderate a conversation with our speaker for the evening, but first I want to share a bit of his biography with you. Colson Whitehead was born in 1969 and was raised in Manhattan. After graduating from Harvard College, he started working for The Village Voice, where he wrote reviews of television, books, and music. Currently, he is a prolific author of 7 and now 8 books, including his debut novel, The Intuitionist, which concerned intrigue in the Department of Elevator Inspectors, and it was a finalist for the Penn Hemingway Award and a winner of the Quality Paperback Book Club's New Voices Award. He's written books such as John Henry Days, The Colossus of New York, Apex Hides the Hurt, Sag Harbor, Zone 1, and The Noble Hustler, Poker, Beef Jerky, and Death. Colson Whitehead is one of the rare talents who transcends genres, who literally transcends time, and is a unique voice for contemporary authors. We're excited to have him here with us today. If you are unfamiliar with his work, please pick up one of his many books, as well as check out his essays that have appeared in the New York Times, The New Yorker, Harper's, as well as Granta. And he has received the prestigious MacArthur Fellowship, a Guggenheim Fellowship, a Whiting Writers Award, and a fellowship for the Coleman Center for Scholars and Writers. I will now yield the floor for him to give a presentation to you, and then we'll proceed to a conversation, and afterwards a question and answer with the audience. Thank you.
Hey, howdy. Thanks for having me. I usually spend Thursday nights at home in my apartment weeping over my regrets, so this is a nice change, see some nice people. And the first place I lived was 139th and Riverside until I was 6 years old. The buildings look different when you're a little taller. So I'd like to start off telling you a bit about my story, how I got started, my journey to this place, if you will, where I'm coming from and where I'm going. I hope you find parts of it entertaining and edifying. I'll start at the beginning. I was born a poor black child. I remember the days sitting on the porch with my family, singing and dancing down in Mississippi. Or maybe that was somebody else. I was born and raised in Manhattan. I was a bit of a shut-in. I would have preferred to have been a sickly child, but it didn't work out that way. I always like it when you read a biography of someone like Joyce or whatever, and it says, they were a sickly child, forced to retreat into a world of imagination. It sounds so wonderful. Instead, I just didn't like going outside. Other kids left their houses and did sports, played in the great outdoors. I like to stay inside watching The Twilight Zone and The Outer Limits. I read a lot of comic books and science fiction, and I adored Stephen King. Writing Spider-Man or the X-Men when I was in junior high seemed like the perfect job. if you were a writer, you could work from home. You didn't have to wear clothes or talk to people, and you could just make up stuff all day. So until I got to college and started reading different stuff, more so-called highbrow fiction, I wanted to write The Black Shining or The Black Salem's Lot. Basically, if you took a Stephen King title and put the black in front of it, that's what I wanted to do. Eventually, I started hitting different kinds of literature freshman year in college, and I liked the equivalency I saw between science fiction and horror and magic realism in Garcia Marquez, the absurdity of Beckett, and the mythical landscapes of Borges. They played with the fantastic as much as the genre writers I grew up reading. And it helps that from my first exposure, I think, I found Samuel Beckett to be a form of high realism. A guy is buried up to his neck in sand, he can't move, he has an itch on his leg, he can't scratch. That just seems like a regular morning to me. I considered myself a writer in college, but I didn't actually sit down and write anything. I wore black and smoked cigarettes, but I didn't actually sit down and write, which apparently is part of the process. I finally wrote two stories, two five-page epics that I used to audition for the creative writing classes, and I was turned down each time. I was very depressed, but looking back, it was fine practice, preparation for being a writer, because when you write, everyone hates you, no one wants to read your stuff, not even people you're married to, and if you internalize that early, you're in good stead for when you actually become a professional writer. I got very lucky when I got out of college. I started working at the Village Voice. The Village Voice is very different then as it was now. For those of you who are a bit younger, what you have to know about the Village Voice is that whenever you were there, it was its heyday, and when you left, it went downhill. So if you were there in the 50s writing about beatnik culture with Norman Mailer, that's when The Voice was in its heyday, and then it went downhill. If you were there in the 70s writing about the birth of hip-hop and disco, that's when The Voice was really great, and then, of course, it went downhill. I was there from 91 to 96. We put out a great product. It's a shame what happened to it since I left. But that's where I started writing journalism. The thing about The Voice was that once you're in there, you could badger and nag people to get work. So after 6 months, I hit up the TV editor. Back then, if you wrote TV criticism, it was a very debased sort of section of the paper. And I got my first assignment, which was writing an article about the series finales of the sitcoms Growing Pains and Who's the Boss. That was my debut. 25 years later, I think it stands up as the definitive think pieces on those two seminal sitcoms. And once I had that one article, I could write for the movie section and the book section, and I started writing pretty regularly. And I had all this time to start writing fiction, because I was freelance, and I decided to write my first novel. And because I was writing criticism, and I was very self-conscious, I didn't want to do the cliched first novel. It was the early 90s, the heyday of so-called Gen X fiction, of sex, drugs, and rock and roll. I didn't want to do that. You know, an example of that might be two people in a cafe in the opening pages, and one person says, "Did you hear what happened?" "No, tell me." "Kurt Cobain died." "What? He was our JFK." And it starts a whole generational exploration. There's the autobiographical first novel that you use to get back at everyone who hurt you when you were a child. I want to save that for my fourth novel, just to mix it up. And then there was the, I guess what I call the novel of Southern Black misery, which takes place in the South and may open up with like two people walking down the road and like, "Oh, it's so hot. I don't have any shoes. It's so hot." I grew up in Manhattan, I have shoes, you know, it wasn't my experience. So I didn't want to do what I saw as a cliched mode of first novel. So instead, I wrote a novel about a Gary Coleman-esque child star who gets abused by the media, grows up and gets abused by the media culture. In the book, he's on a show called "I'm Movin' In," apostrophe on the move-in. Because in the 70s, the sitcoms were all about the apostrophe. There was Different Strokes, like What's Happening, And so I'm moving in seemed like a sop to realism. So I was very excited. I got an agent, and we started sending a book out, and then we started hearing back from people. I, for one, was very surprised that a book about the misadventures of a Gary Coleman-esque child star would fail to find its footing in the marketplace. The rejection slips began to accumulate, and I started to have some really bizarre thoughts. When I first became aware of Top 40 radio, it was the late 70s, so that meant a lot of disco. The Bee Gees, Diana Ross, Donna Summer. And for years I tried to figure out what the song MacArthur Park was about. I grew up on the Donna Summer version. Perhaps some of you are more acquainted with the Richard Harris version. And I realize that there's some young people here who have no idea what I'm talking about. So I brought an audio aid. The song poses an enigma. Who left the cake out in the rain and why? Was it a birthday, some childhood feud finally come to fruition? I wasn't sure. I didn't know until I started getting all these rejection letters as I sat around my underwear watching Jerry Springer with the shades drawn, surrounded by beer cans. It was then that I finally understood what the song MacArthur Park is really about. MacArthur Park is an investigation of the artist's journey. I'd gone to a lot of trouble gathering ingredients. And when I was done, someone left the cake out in the rain. All the sweet green icing was flowing down. I didn't think that I could take it, because it took so long to bake it. And I would never, ever, ever have that recipe again. Knopf Publishing Group, why did you leave my cake out in the rain? Houghton Mifflin Publishing Group, why did you leave my cake out in the rain? Atlas Vanity Publishing of Secaucus, New Jersey, why did you not even return my phone calls? That was so weird. I started thinking about what else I could do. My parents were of that generation that if you're an able-bodied black person, it was your duty to make something of yourself, uplift the race, become a lawyer, a doctor, an accountant. Well, those professions weren't up my alley, so I tried to think about what else I might be able to do. And here I call your attention to my slender, delicate fingers and thin, feminine wrists. I bring them up not out of shame, but just to point out I'm not cut out for certain kinds of work. Far from feeling shame, in fact, I'm quite delighted with myself these days because we stand at an important moment in our country's history when a skinny black man with slender fingers and thin feminine wrists has actually become president. So if it's ever going to be our time, this is probably it. But back to my hands. These are hands that say pianist, hand model, surgeon. Were these professions I might be suited for? Could I play the piano? Well, let me tell you a little story. The first thing I bought when I got a decent paycheck was an ergonomic chair. I slouch, I can't type, I hunt and peck. And when I was writing Intuitionist, I had to pop Advil all day because my neck was all messed up from being hunched over. How could I sit at a piano bench without armrests, no lumbar support? I could not be a pianist. On paper, being a hand model must seem like the life. You get free watches, free hand cream, travel a lot, meet interesting people in the international jet set. But I had a very conservative upbringing. How could I indulge in a model lifestyle? I read all these stories about Kate Moss. This was the early 90s, so that was out. Finally, surgeon. I was all set to go to med school, just head on down there and sign up, whatever you do. And then I heard about how long operations are. You have to stand on your feet for like 10, 15, 20 hours straight. What if you have to go to the bathroom? This thought just kept running through my mind. What if you have to go to the bathroom with your hands in this person's guts? Half the reason I got into the writing business was so that I could sit on my ass all day. So I tried to break it down scientifically. The average book of literary fiction sells 5,000 copies. 5,000 copies if you're lucky. Now, assuming everyone loves this book, doesn't just throw it in the trash in disgust, and in addition makes 10 other people read it, let's say this book has 50,000 readers, 50,000 people who like it. Well, there are 6 billion people in the world. You've made an impact in the lives of 0.0000001% of the population. You're not a gnat trying to catch the attention of an elephant. You're a microbe in the butt of a gnat trying to catch the attention of an elephant. And I know there's some young writers in the room, so I don't want to scare you. I just pulled the 5,000 number out of the air. I was trying to Google it before I got here, but I couldn't figure out the right search terms. I'm not supposed to use Google as much as I do. I'm supposed to go to the library and Google's digitizing all the books, and we're going to stop reading books on paper. But I can't help it. I want Google for everything. Like, I want a Google superego. Like when I'm out drinking and I think, maybe I'll have one more beer, the Google superego will go, did you mean go home right now? Or I'm sitting around and I'm like, look, there's a 10-hour Project Runway marathon on Bravo, I think I'll watch it. The Google superego will go, did you mean read a book and tell your family how much you love them? I think it'd be a killer app. But where was I? The population of Earth. It's very intimidating. Well, what about life on other planets? You might naturally ask yourself next. Perhaps there is life on other planets, and they have a taste for language poetry, creative nonfiction, coming-of-age novels. Well, I hate to burst your bubble, but scientists say that the nearest planet outside our solar system is 10.5 light years away. That's pretty far. And the chance of one of our Earth scientists coming up with a faster-than-light drive in our lifetime is quite slim. Estimates about the possibility of life on other planets vary. Some say that only 1 in 100 million planets is capable of supporting life. And what's the chance they would like your crap anyway? They could be all about the haiku up there. So you're out of luck. And I got very depressed thinking about all this. And then I thought, maybe it's out of my hands. Maybe I have no choice. A friend of mine is a real jerk. He has some fine qualities, but there's no escaping he's a real jerk sometimes. And for years, I've wondered how he came to be such a jerk. And then it occurred to me, evolution. For generations, jerks have been breeding with other jerks to produce more jerks, who in turn breed with other jerks and have litters of jerks in turn. It must have started thousands of years ago when some Neanderthal jerk got together with another Neanderthal jerk in a cave. Perhaps they met while fighting over a piece of saber-toothed meat and just clicked, started talking about the weather. Oh, gluck gluck, the thunder god is quite angry today, don't you think? Yeah, you're right, and you have really pretty eyes too. And it was pure chemistry, and they took it from there. And they had a child, and their jerk kid got together with another Neanderthal jerk's kid, or Neanderthal of similar type, a moron or a douche. And they had a kid who was half jerk, half douche, and so on for millennia, more or less breeding and concentrating unpleasant qualities until my friend was born. So I figure it's the same with writers. Their artistic temperament must go back just as far. There was a Neanderthal who paused while beating in the skull of a Neanderthal from the next cave over, and he thought to himself, hunting and gathering, gathering and hunting. Is that all there is to this miserable life? And he became the first Neanderthal existentialist. And he found a Neanderthal of melancholy temperament, a Neanderthal female who liked to draw non-representational doodles on the cave wall, and she became the first abstract artist. And they had a kid who didn't like to hunt or gather, but just tell stories all day. And he found a suitable mate and so on throughout the centuries, spawning moody, arty kids. In the 1600s, one villager says to another, "Hey, did you see that new puppet show last night?" And the artistic villager says, "No, I don't watch puppet shows. I don't even own a puppet show set. I only listen to NPR. And so on to the present day, all that artistic DNA surviving and getting together. So as I sat in my dirty studio apartment, watching Jerry Springer, indeed relating all too deeply to Jerry Springer, I realized that I was a recipient of all that sit on your ass, muse about crap all day DNA. And it didn't matter if no one liked what I was doing. I had no choice. So I got back to work, and the publishing thing went better the next time. One thing I really wanted when I started writing was a guide to how to get started. I think it would have been very helpful. And it also comes at a time in every writer's life when it is time to edit an anthology. So a year and a half ago, I thought, why not assemble an anthology on the writer's craft? So I'm calling it How to Write and the Art of Writing, Writers Writing About Writing. The idea is simple. Today's best writers on the topic of their choice. In short, writers writing about writing. So I sent out a lot of letters to prominent people in the publishing industry, writers, editors, nonfiction writers, some poets. And one of the first people to get back to me was Jim Phillips, who gave me the following wonderful essay I'll share with you called How to Write. Jim Phillips, of course, is the author of several works of fiction, including the novels Can't Get There From Here, You Gotta Know When to Fold 'Em, and the award-winning colloquial phrase I will use as a title. Last year he published the acclaimed work of cultural history, Ding Dang Dong, The True Story of Frere Jacques, Methamphetamine, and Chronic Insomnia. So this is his essay, How to Write. The art of writing can be reduced to a few simple rules. I share them with you now. Rule number one, show and tell. Most people say show, don't tell, but I stand by show and tell. Because when writers put their work out into the world, they're like little kids bringing their broken unicorns and chewed up teddy bears to class in the sad hope that someone else will love them as much as they do. And what do you have for us today, Marcy? It's a penetrating psychological study of a young med student who receives disturbing news from a former lover. How marvelous, have a juice box. And Timmy, what are you holding there behind your back? It's a Calvino-esque romp through an unnamed metropolis, much like New York, narrated by an armadillo. Such an imagination, have a juice box. Show and tell, followed by a good nap. Rule number two, don't go searching for your subject, let your subject find you. You can't rush inspiration. How do you think Truman Capote came to In Cold Blood? It was just an ordinary day, and he picked up the paper to read his horoscope, and it was right there, fate. Whether it's a harrowing account of a multiple homicide, a botched Everest expedition, or a family of colorful singers trying to escape from Austria when the Nazis invade, you can't force it. Once your subject finds you, it's like falling in love. It'll be your constant companion, shadowing you, peeping in your windows, calling you at all hours of the night to leave messages like, only you understand me. Your ideal subject should be like a stalker with limitless resources. He's in your apartment pawing your stuff when you're not around, using your toothbrush and cutting out all the really good synonyms from the thesaurus. Don't be afraid. You have a bestseller on your hands. Rule number three, write what you know. Saul Bellow once said, fiction is the higher biography. In other words, fiction is payback on those who have wronged you. When people read my first two books, my gym teacher was an abusive bully and she called them Brussels sprouts, a survivor's tale. They're often surprised when I tell them that there's an autobiographical element to them. Therein lies the art, I say. How do you take that, which is your everyday, and make it into the stuff of art? Listen to this. Listen to your heart. Ask your heart, is it true? And if it is, let it be. Once the lawyers sign off on it, you're good to go. Rule number four, never use three words when one will do. Be concise. Don't fall in love with the gentle trilling of your mellifluous sentences. Learn how to kill your darlings, as they say. I'm reminded of the famous editor-author interaction between Gordon Lish and Raymond Carver when they were working on Raymond Carver's celebrated short story, "Those life preservers are just for show," often considered the high watermark of so-called dirty realism. You'll recall the climax, of course, when the two drunken fishermen try to calm each other after their dinghy springs a leak. In the original last lines of the story, Nat, the salty old part-time insurance agent, reassures his young charge as they cling to the beer cooler. "We'll get help once we hit land, I'm sure of it. No more big waves, no more sharks. We'll be safe once again, we'll be home." If you visit the Lilly Library at the University of Indiana and look at Gordon Lish's papers, you will see how, with but a few deft strokes, he pared that down to create the now legendary ending, "Help, land shark." It wasn't what Carver intended, but few could argue was not shorter. Rule number five, keep a dream diary. Rule number six, what's not said is as important as what is said. In many classic short stories, the real action occurs in the silences. Try to keep all the good stuff off the page. Some real-world practice might help. Next time your partner comes home, ignore his or her existence for 30 minutes and then blurt out, "This is it," and drive the car onto the neighbor's lawn. When your child approaches at bedtime, squeeze their shoulder meaningfully, and if you're a woman, smear your lipstick across your face with your back of your wrist, or if you're a man, weep violently until they say, "It's okay, Dad." Drink out of a chipped mug, a souvenir from a family vacation or weekend getaway in better times, one that can trigger a two-paragraph compare-contrast description later on. It's a bit like method acting, but you'll get the hang of it. Simply let this thought guide your every word and gesture. Something is wrong. Can you guess what it is? If you're going for something a little more pomo, repeat the above, but with fish. Rule number seven. Writer's block is a tool. Use it wisely. When asked why you haven't produced anything lately, just say, "I'm blocked." Since most people think that writing is some mystical process where your characters talk to you and you can hear their voices in your head, being blocked is the perfect cover for when you just don't feel like writing. The gods of creativity bless you, they forsake you, it's out of your hands and whatnot. Writer's block is like, "We couldn't get a babysitter," or "I ate some bad shrimp." An excuse that always gets a pass. But don't overdo it. In the same way the babysitter bit loses credibility when your kids are off in grad school, there's an expiration date. After 20 years, you might want to mix it up. Throw in a Ralph Ellisonian, "Oops, my house caught fire and burnt up my opus." The specifics don't matter. The important thing is to figure out what works for you. Rule number eight is secret. Rule number nine, have adventures. Have adventures. The Hemingway mode was in ascendancy for decades until it was eclipsed by trendy, fabulous exercises. The pendulum is swinging back, though, and it's going to knock these effete eggheads right out of their Aeron chairs. Keep ahead of the curve. Get out and see the world. It's not going to kill you to butch it up for once. Book passage on a tramp steamer. Rustle up some dysentery. It's worth it for the fever dreams alone. lose a kidney in a knife fight. You'll be glad you did. Rule number 10, revise, revise, revise. I cannot stress this enough. Revision is when you do what you should have done the first time, but didn't. It's like washing the dishes 2 days later instead of right after you finish eating. Get that draft counter going. Remove a comma and then print out another copy. That's another draft right there. Do that enough times and you can really get those numbers up, which will come in handy when someone challenges you to a draft off. When the referee blows the whistle and your opponent goes, 37 drafts, you bust out with 217 and send them to the mat. Finally, rule number 11. There are no rules. If everyone jumped off a bridge, would you do it too? No. There are no rules except the ones you learned during your show and tell days. Have fun. If they don't want to be friends with you, they're not worth being friends with. And most of all, just be yourself. So that's it for weird fake writing advice. And now I'm going to read a short part from Sag Harbor, which came out a couple years ago. It was a very good time. I wrote it at the Coleman Center, which is a very good place to work. And so basically this takes place in 1985, I think, in Sag Harbor, Long Island. Some kids who live in Manhattan but go out to Long Island in the summer. Not a lot happens in the story. It's not action-packed. In chapter 8, the main character gets his braces off. That's like the big suspenseful sequence. A lot of momentum in the story builds up to that moment. It's very emotional when he gets his braces off. This is another moment of great drama when he's getting a haircut. His father likes to drink and cut his hair. As I sat on a chair in a bathroom, holding a towel tight around my bony shoulders and staring into the black and white subway tile, he trimmed and trimmed, grumbling about the light, tilting my head to and fro with a firm push of his index and middle fingers. He drew up tufts with a pick and squinted and clipped. I murmured the prime directive to myself, don't move your head, do not move your head, even though it never worked. I moved. He always told me I moved no matter how much I concentrated, no matter how many pledges I devised between haircuts, as if a new arrangement of words might make things turn out differently next time. At some point, he'd say, you moved your head, now I gotta even it out. And I cursed myself as he cut and cut, and my fro grew shorter and shorter and shorter. But when he was done, it was perfect, like when he grilled. You had to admit that despite everything, he was a master griller. It was one of those things he did well. It was a cornerstone of our reality. He gave us miniature versions of his own haircut, the same one he'd given himself since high school, when he took over haircut duties from his father. The haircuts remained perfect for whole hours. Don't be thrown off by the fact that no camera ever recorded them. The spell broke when he took a shower or slept on them, whereupon all his tucks and pats and proddings were undone and our superb crowns became utterly misshaped and disordered, the underlying principles revealed as counterfeit. What occurred on my scalp could not be called a style in any true sense, and it got wilder the longer it got. It was a strange black amoeba testing the edges of itself, throwing out nappy pseudopods here and suddenly there, a new unpredictable direction every day. I swear it lived, and have come to believe that it's ever-shifting lumps and tendrils were a doomed attempt at communication with the humans. The tragedy of the day after haircuts, and all the days after. The months passed until we had to admit that society hated us, and the process started anew. Needless to say, I had no idea how fucked up the haircuts were at the time. To us, they were normal, just how things were done in our house. Raise your hand if you can relate. My delusions ended that spring when I was cleaning out my desk during one of my periodic purges of my nerdery. My 20-sided die from Dungeons and Dragons possessed a curious will, returning to pester and trouble me, even though I'd thrown it out 100 times before the specter of D&D games passed. This time I threw it out the window, and I found it under the radiator a week later. That's the magic realism part of the book. I stashed dog-eared copies of Fangoria in a box at the back of my closet and hid all the comic books I'd bought since the last purge in case a girl materialized in my room due to a transporter malfunction. I was in a good mood or something, feeling optimistic, like someone had chuckled at a joke I made in history or biology, and it had gone to my head. I came across a packet of fifth grade class pictures under my copy of Swamp Thing number 35. It is the horrible quality of elementary school pictures to reveal the true natures of our childhoods. Nothing is how we remember it, and all the necessary alterations we've made in order to survive with semi-functioning psyches are exposed. Best to leave them alone. Looking back, I think I had what is best described as a pre-lapsarian fondness for fifth grade, its lack of complication, no more. Miss Fredericks, the social studies teacher whose cruel smile had haunted me for years, had a melancholy face now that I really looked at it. She seemed a bit too skinny, almost ill, and I got to thinking about what her house looked like, picturing the shadows in the kitchenette where she prepared her lonely meals, two scoops of cottage cheese and a big leaf of wilted iceberg lettuce and a side of misery. She never appeared in my dreams again. Staring at the rest of the photograph, it was clear that none of us, teacher and pupils alike, had remained untouched by that horrible epidemic making the rounds back then. 70s fashion, the manic stripes and prints of the shirts and skirts and pants, a kind of rash on our flesh that only a new decade could cure. Then there were the kids themselves. No one looked like they were supposed to. These changeling creatures surrounded me in polyester, touching my elbows. Strangers. I traced a finger along their faces like a movie amnesiac. That must be my best friend. His name is Andy. And there's the smart girl who sat in front of me all year. She ate frankfurters out of a bionic woman thermos filled with hot, oily water. Then there was my own face. My face was not the one I remembered showing to the world. Were my eyes so dark those days? There was something amiss with my mouth, always my mouth, even before I got braces. My lips were chapped, sure, but the chappiness seemed to have extended its territory so that a huge white halo encircled my mouth, like I've been eating ashes for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. And there was that thing on top, that really fucked up haircut. I recovered from the class picture pretty quickly. It wasn't that bad. Seeing the white letters identifying my homeroom, I felt a nice warm tingle of nostalgia. The killer was the four panes of wallet-sized photos beneath the class picture. They should have stopped me. They should have stopped me at any number of checkpoints. As I tried to leave the apartment here, a close relative would have been key. The doorman could have taken me aside. We got along, him and me, trading haze with enthusiasm, or so I thought, but he said nothing. Certainly the bus driver, de facto deputy of the body politic, could have forbid me entry, ripping my bus pass in half and tossing it to the dirty black treads. The security guard outside school should have beat me with his flashlight. And certainly my homeroom teacher, Miss Barrett, should have shoved her big wooden desk up against the door to forbid me entry, back brace or no back brace. All of them should have said, "What the fuck is up with your hair?" Obviously, it had been months since my last trim. Instead of a haircut, the photographer had captured some primordial process unfolding. The universe tugged and pressed on my hair with invisible fingers, the same way it had pulled up mountains to the sky and gouged the deepest ocean chasms. What else is there to say but it that in my vicinity, larger forces were at work, the ancient underpinnings of it all. There are natural laws. The third law of thermodynamics says that a temperature approaches absolute zero, the entropy of a system approaches a constant. Sir Isaac Newton's third law of motion holds that for every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. The entity on my head was proof of another fundamental law. A fucked up afro tends towards complete fucked upness at an exponential rate over time, as expressed by the equation AN equals F times T. AN equals F times T, where AN is absolute nappiness, F is fucked upness, and T is time. The pain of photos was uncut, of course. Who'd want a picture of that in their wallet, poisoning their money? Thank you.
Is this on? Can you hear me well? Wonderful. Can we have another round of applause for Mr. Whitehead? Thank you for sharing. One of the things I'm struck with is just your creativity and how you move in different ways. Could you describe a little bit about your overall project in writing or what you see your contribution is?
Yeah, I think my contribution is something for other people to say. In terms of my project, I just try to do something different each time. Once I'm done with the book, I'm very much done with that style or that subject. I want to do something differently. So my first book was The Intuitionist. I talked about my first book in the opening part of my talk. Everyone hated my Gary Coleman book, so I figured I'd write a book with plot, and that became The Intuitionist. Just trying to write a book with a strong structure. And then that book was so plot-oriented and had a main character who was so repressed that my next book, John Henry Days, was very expansive, had a lot of different voices, and that became a sort of antidote to The Intuitionist. So, I tried just not to do the same thing twice. I have preoccupations, race and technology and pop culture, New York City, and they're in some books, not in others. And I just, I think by writing a post-apocalyptic horror book like Zone One, I was paying tribute to my early influences, whether it's Stephen King or Escape from New York or Planet of the Apes, and learning how to write in that style. And then the book after that was a nonfiction book about playing in a World Series of Poker. So by just working different genres, it makes the work becomes real and vital to me because I'm trying to figure out how to do a horror novel and preserve what I want from the tradition, but also deform it for my own purposes. I'm not in a horror writer's guild, so I don't have to do anything. I want to do it my own way, but also salute what I like in the tradition. I read a lot of different stuff. I think people should read what they want, and I read thrillers, and I read literary fiction. I read thrillers that are literary fiction. I've taken a lot of sustenance from different genres at different points in my life, and so writing a nonfiction book or a horror novel or a straight novel of realism like Sag Harbor just keeps the work vital for me.
Thank you. Speaking about just like you pull from culture and pop culture in so many ways, what are you reading now? What's on your iPod? Like, if we weren't in your head, what would we hear?
Well, I'm handing a book on Friday, so I haven't read anything for a long time. So I have a stack of books, and so I want to read the new Marlon James. I read the book of Night Women last fall and loved it. I had started The Streets of Laredo a few months ago, and I was like, I'm working, I can't read it. So I loved Lonesome Dove and Larry McMurtry, so now I'm reading a sequel. I'm very excited. I was up all night till 2 a.m. reading my iPad in the dark. There's a series of books called The Southern Reach Trilogy by Jeff Vandermeer. Science fiction. Kelly Link has a book of short stories I started and put down because I was working. So a lot of different stuff.
Cool. Would you tell us a little bit about novel number 8, the one that's coming in?
Sure, yeah. So my last book was nonfiction, so back to novels. It's about the Underground Railroad, and I haven't really figured out how to explain it yet. it has some fantastical stuff in it, but I'm doing it with more of a straight face than I have in the past, and so... basically, a woman is in Georgia and trying to escape north, and you know, when you first hear about the Underground Railroad when you're six, you think it's a real railroad. So it's a real railroad in this book, and each time she gets off a new state, it's a different state of American possibility. And so there's a white supremacist state, there's a black separatist state, there's a sort of paternalistic white state, wasteland, and so she moves from this different state, just trying to get north, has wacky adventures. Actually, not wacky at all. It's a really depressing book. There's no jokes in it. It's horrifying, as it is when you are dealing with slavery and you sort of have an idea from history and things you read a long time ago, and then you actually read, you know, the slave narratives, the WPA's testimonies from the 30s when they interviewed 80-year-old and 90-year-old former slaves, and you realize what you think you know is only a sliver of how actually horrible you know, things you went through.
When you're writing, do you have a particular audience in mind, or does that vary by novel, or?
I thought with the Intuitionist, I would do my first reading, and there'd be a bunch of weird 16-year-old black guys look like me, skinny freaks. Then I went to my first reading, and it was not. It was a lot of different kinds of people. And so I learned that I have no idea who's going to like this book or that book. And some people like my fiction and not my fiction and not my nonfiction. Some people liked the realism of Sag Harbor, and then heard Zone 1 was coming out, and they're like, zombies, I don't read horror. So different, you know, I don't know what books, what audience is going to come to each book. They are sort of different. And I can definitely see why you would not like Zone 1 or not like to read about a book about poker. Mm. I only have a choice in what I write about, I've learned. So I have no idea what the audience is. I'm just glad that I can invite nice places and sell a few books.
Right on. In your writing process, do you start right in with a clear portrait of a novel? Do you work through short stories? Do you write snippets and see what resonates?
I don't write short stories, and I'm a big outliner. So before I start writing, I figure out the beginning and the end. The middle could be a little bit fuzzy, but I definitely have to know what's going to happen to the main character at the end. So before I start writing, yeah, I'm outlining for 6 months. And I guess in my nerdy way, I feel that if you don't, it's hard enough to find the right words each day. If you don't actually know what's going to happen in the book, it seems twice as hard. So each day, you know, my outline, and I'm like, I have to introduce the sheriff. I have to introduce the DA. I introduce the butler who killed the person that you find out in the last act. And I have a task, and then I finish that, and that's three paragraphs or three pages, and I go on to the next the next section. When I was younger, I would just skip around and whatever I felt like writing that day, I would write. And so with books that are more modular, like The Intuitionist and John Henry Days, which skip around a lot, if I was sick of my main character, I could, or I was stuck, I could do like a historical section or three historical sections and then come back to the main narrative line in 96. Nowadays, I like to go straight through, and that seems to make more sense. I think, when I was younger, there were things I was excited to write, and so I would skip ahead and write them. And now, and then you can just write all the fun parts and just be stuck with all the hard parts. So if you space out the hard parts and the fun parts, it seems to make more sense to me nowadays.
Nice. One of the things that I was speaking to a student about earlier today was the form and the length of writing. He mentioned, well, when he started out, he's like, I like writing, but the longer it gets, the harder it gets. And do I want to make the leap to a longer format? How did you transition from like the Village Voice to coming out with a novel, like Helmy Anderson?
Yeah, I've written like three short stories my whole life. I my ideas were always just sort of like, were sort of bigger that, you know, I love reading short stories, I just don't know how to do them, and the kind of more conceptual stuff I like to think about and write about ends up being much longer than a short story can contain. So, you know, you just have to learn how to be your boss and sit down and write every day. I was very depressed with my Gary Coleman novel. It didn't take off, and...
Is that real?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, it's there. It's terrible. but if you're going to write a novel, it's going to take years, and so you have to realize, like, I just think if you write a paragraph, you're a paragraph closer, and then if you write three paragraphs a week, that's like a page and a half, and you're a page and a half closer to the end. And then, you know, I mean, I try to write 8 pages a week. That's my process. It can be Monday and Tuesday, or Thursday and Sunday, as long as I made my sort of quota. I'm the kind of person who needs like a whole day. If I have like a doctor's appointment at 2, I'm like, oh, the day's ruined, you know. So if I get 3 days where I have like 9 to 3 p.m. free, that's, yeah, really great. Some people have to have 2 hours to work. We all have busy lives, and if that's your 2 hours or 1 hour, that's how you get it done. 5 hours a week, that's, you know, could be 3 pages, could be 5 pages, and then 5 pages a week, that's 20 pages a month. That's half a novel by the end of the year. In 2 years, you have a novel. So, a lot of work in there, despair. But every sentence is a victory, every paragraph is a victory, and it adds up. So, making the leap is just adjusting your idea of how long it's going to take to finish, and you're going to be miserable for a long time. If you know, there are no jokes in a new book, but when I write a joke, I have to wait like a year and a half for someone to laugh at it. Is it a dumb joke? Is it a good joke? Or if you realize something about the plot, like the butler did it, you can't like tell your friends, like, I realized the butler did it because you didn't want to ruin it for them. You know, so it's like every sort of minor victory you have in a day-to-day process ends up being a little secret. So you have to get used to that, just sort of being happy with whatever you can get done in a day or a week, you know.
And we're going to open it up to audience questions in a moment. One of the last things I want to ask you is, what's probably the worst advice you've gotten on writing?
I don't keep it, so I ignore it. But worst advice, I don't know, write what you know. Well, you know, you write fiction, it's nice to make up stuff. But then also you should write what you know, so you don't come off like a jerk. I'm not sure. I mean, with all the, you know, I sort of make fun of writing rules in that piece I read, and whatever works for you is what you should do. You shouldn't, when people say you have to write every day, no. If that doesn't work for you, don't do it. I don't like writing every day. Sometimes I don't feel like it. And I'd rather watch a movie and play video games, and that's what I do. Get a book on writing. There are plenty of good ones out there. And if something seems totally off base to you, say that I work for this person, not for me, and figure out what works for you.
Cool. Excellent.
Oh, also, write what you want to write, not what you think people should think you should be writing. If you want to write romances or horror or science fiction, life is short. You should really just spend your time working on the stuff you want to work on, not what you think you should be writing as a woman or a black person or a person from the South. Figure out what you want to say and say it, and not what you think people are telling you you should be doing.
So from what I hear, we're going to get that Gary Coleman novel.
Well, you know, there are like 2 similes in there, and I use them in other books. The rest is pretty terrible. Maybe if my kids has a gambling problem and they're older, they can sell it or something, or I'm not really sure. It's up to them. I'll be dead soon.
All right. Awesome. Thank you. And in the back of the room, Sophia has a microphone for those who have questions. So raise your hand, and we'll go in an orderly fashion. Stand.
Thank you for this just absolutely amazing session. And you know, because you're working with such different genres, and it involves such immense research, right, to be able to really set up the context and give the characters the life that matches with the context. My question is about how does the research for each genre kind of play into the new project? Like how does that research actually start a conversation between, you know, the genres that you write, that they alter the structure and add to the structure in unknown or known ways?
No, sure. I mean, each book is different, and so, and in terms of how much research I do or don't want to do, this last book was, you know, the Underground Railroad book was very research heavy. For the poker book, I went to Atlantic City and learned how to play tournament poker, and then went to the World Series of Poker and interviewed some people, and that was that sort of research. But I always think I'm ready to start writing, and then I'll read something, some book I was putting off, and then I realized how much I didn't know about what I'm writing about, and research really just feeds the work and makes it more rich. I'm handing my book in on Friday. There's some stuff that I might read over Christmas, and maybe when I'm revising, some things can go in there. And then it's sort of over. I don't want to know anything about it anymore. So each book is different. I mean, I love doing research because that's, it really does makes the world richer and to send you all down different sort of avenues. And then also it's nice to start making things up. And so I like to get enough research and influences to get going and then sort of take off. And then if I hit a slow patch, go back and read some more. And so I'm always going back and forth, and I don't do all the research before I start. I take breaks and figure out what I can next read that will help me in the next stage.
And on my left, you're right.
Hi, thank you so much. I love your books. You're an amazing writer, and I really appreciate your use of vocabulary. And I find that the way that you show how well you understand the word is really incredible. But this is a question, and it's about MFAs, and what do you think is the best way to get the most out of a writing degree? This is my first semester here, and I'm really enjoying it, but I'm finding that I'm not writing as much as I thought I would be.
Well, I think, I think the deadlines are great. You have to produce, and you have to hand stuff in, and so, if you don't have an internal fascist, as I call it, having workshop deadlines can help you with that. You have a built-in audience. No one wants to, when you're out of your MFA, no one wants to read your stuff, but people, when you're getting a degree, are sort of forced to, and you have people who have been writing for decades who can help you along. So you're not going to have that once you get out, probably. So while I never want anyone to come to my office hours, definitely avail yourself of your teachers while you're here. And also the community. I mean, you're 10 people in a room, you're all in the same position, you're starting out, you're trying different things. After 2 years, you're not going to be writing the same kind of stuff you're writing when you came in. You're going to have setbacks, you're going to have jumps in ability. And that's just part of the process. So sort of know that, be open to criticism. There's gonna be some jerk in your class, some loud mouth is always wrong, and then 2 years from now you'll be like, oh, actually Jimmy was right about how I always have like this extra clause in a sentence. So even if you don't take it in right in that class, put it in the back of your head and maybe revisit later. So I think you want to find a program that's cheap. No, writers makes a little money, you don't want to go into debt to get a writing degree. You want to hopefully have an affinity with it. You're attracted to a place because you like the teachers who are there and you read their work and you are going to work with them. I know there's a cliche about like writing programs churn out the same story. I've never seen that. I mean, it's sort of like a really dumb thing to say. I mean, every teacher is different, every program is different. And if you're in a program where everyone writes the same, you really made a big error, you know? But I've never seen that. I've taught, you know, a bunch of different places. So I think it's a great 2 years where you're sort of off to the side. Hopefully you have enough time to write. You know, as I said, I sort of need a lot of time to write. And if you're juggling job, families, kids, that sort of precious time where you have a class and people who you're going through the same thing with can be really precious, and it's only there for 2 years. So I guess short, make the most of it. Howdy.
We're taping it, so it'll pick you up.
Sure.
Good afternoon. Good evening. Listening to your stories and hearing about you being here, I actually started doing my research on you. And I found that I liked the premises of your stories. I felt that they gave me an idea of the time, to say the least. Listening now to you and hearing you talk about comic books, horror films, and what you watched as a youngster, do you see yourself going an Afrofuturistic genre, even with your books? Because, I mean, your books now do jump through a lot of different timelines, to say the least. But you do tackle topics that are pretty much timeless, you know, for our community, to say the least. Would you see yourself, based on your foundations being in comic books and stuff?
Doing that? I mean, I think, you know, science fiction and fantasy literature definitely inform my work. Some people think that the Intuitionist fits into the Afrofuturist category, you know, sort of alternative New York, where elevator inspectors are very important, and it deals with social uplift and technology. So, I mean, I sort of write what I want, what I write, and I don't put myself in categories. And when I'm working in a certain sort of vein, I'm taking from it what I like, and I'm also trying to put my own spin on it. So I wouldn't sort of put myself in different categories. I think other people can or not. I think most people don't read my books and are happy not to categorize my work. In terms of what I'll do in the future, maybe, would I write something that's more straight sort of sci-fi? You know, it could be. You know, I never thought I'd write a book about poker or a book about an apocalypse in New York. So, quite possibly down the road.
Would you do a comic book or a screenplay with classic gore?
I think, collaboration is weird. I've written some screenplays, and then I was like 30 pages in. I'm like, this is so hard. I'll just write a novel instead. Like, I know how to write a novel. Like, screenplay has fewer words, but novels seem a little easier. So I've been talking with some friends who are working on a TV show. Maybe that might pan out, like an animated series that actually is science fiction, but it probably won't go anywhere. So, I like mixing it up, and I've been teaching for a while, so what can I do that is sort of maybe not teaching for a while? Maybe it's writing for TV or film or something. I don't know. I like teaching. But sometimes I get offers. So it's really just about like where I am. Like, if I'm in the middle of something, I don't want to drop it for an offer that comes in. Some years I like teaching, some years I like writing, some years I like mixing it up. So.
Can you describe yourself as a reader and talk about what you read and how that might impact you as a writer?
Yeah, well, I think I like to read a lot of different kinds of stuff, and so I don't read a lot of Westerns, but I just love The Streets of Laredo. I think it's just a beautiful little book. I just hear something described in a certain sort of way, I get intrigued, and then I want to pick it up. And so, a lot of nonfiction. I guess it's hard. I'm not, you know, I think when I was younger, I definitely read a lot more, and now I'm like all tired and I have kids, and you know, I have no attention span because of like the internet and stuff like that. I don't know, I'm finding that question strangely hard to answer. I'm sorry.
So one of the things you said a moment ago reminded me of sometimes resisting categories, but also writing against. Can you say a bit about a book like Sag Harbor, which is definitely about black boys and summer, but in a very different setting? Was that challenging for publishing houses, or has it been something that moves the register in our discussion?
Well, I mean, for me, I've been fortunate enough to have been with the same publisher since The Intuitionist. And I think when you write a book about African-American elevator inspector in alternative New York, you're sort of signed on for weirdness. And so a coming-of-age story set on Long Island is actually a very conventional thing to sell in terms of what I brought to them. But they've been very supportive, you know, with all of my stuff, so I'm, you know, very fortunate. The difficulties came in that I didn't want it to be a traditional coming-of-age novel where there's like artificial suspense where like they find a body in the woods and what do? Or like the KKK is like in the woods and someone sees something they shouldn't, and you know, the KKK is after them. So it wasn't gonna be plot heavy, so how do you keep it interesting? And hopefully Benji, the main character, his voice and perceptions are interesting enough to take the place of plot. I think I've written books that are plot heavy and some books that aren't, and I think if you take away an element that the readers like, you have to give something in return. So I think in terms of, if you take away a element that people like plot, you have to have a winning voice or a really great character to take the place of that kind of structural element. So finding his voice, finding what sort of minor teenage events I could elevate in a tiny way. They're not finding dead bodies, but they're discovering themselves using pop culture. So, takes place in 85. So how can I use pop culture that they're into to talk about the larger themes in the book? So it takes place in 85, and 85 was like a year of UTFO, a very corny group. Like one guy's a doctor, one guy's the educated rapper who like uses like big words. And hip hop is sort of corny at that age, at that stage. But in 3 years, you're gonna have gangster rap, and so. In the same way, the music is growing up and getting darker and more complex and more grim, these boys are about to become men, and their lives are becoming more complex and more grim. And so the way that the music is growing up parallels their growing up. And so when they're talking about UTFO versus gangster rap on the horizon, that becomes a way of animating these very sort of smaller adolescent moments. So it's figuring out how to make, you know, I think early on I decided I was gonna narrate a summer, and I think in the summer you're only like, you know, 0%, 0.1% smarter than you were at the beginning. And so how do you make that 0.1%, you know, dramatic? And so finding little moments, whether it's your first job or first kiss or a BB gun fight in the woods at night, and elevating that to something that's very dramatic, and can also speak to people who aren't going out to Long Island, who don't have summer homes, who don't have this experience. How can I tap into a universal teenage experience that transcends just 1985 African American Long Island? So that was the hard part with that book.
Colson, let me say that how much I appreciate, particularly in Zone One, the kind of anthropomorphic aspects of the New York skyline and the buildings. But what do you make of the Marlon James and A Brief History of Seven Killings, and he won the Man Booker Prize for that. Ta-Nehisi Coates and Between the World and Me, the National Book Award. Is there a bright light out there for black male writers now?
I think, you know, the Coates book is great. I haven't read the new Marlon James. Now that I'm actually done with my own stuff, I can read other people's stuff.
So it was exciting, you know, to see those books, you know, get the recognition that, that they did, those writers. I think any time you recognize a moment, it's over. But I think, you know, there've been a lot of great books coming out. I feel excited about what I'm working on. I guess I'm in the, you know, hanging the book in phase, and like, what are people going to think of it? I don't know. I mean, I think you're always just writing. You're doing the, trying to do the best you can, and some years people are going to like what you're writing, and some years people aren't. All you can do is just, you know, do the best you can with each book, and you're never going to know what sort of social or cultural tides it's going to be released into. And then it comes out and does this or does that, and then you start working in. And that's sort of the sad reality of what we sort of do. But it's been a great year for people like Coates and Marlon James. So.
Hi, nice to see you both. Thank you. Hello. Question for you about readers. Colson, you talked a little bit earlier about, like, you're a writer, you want people to read your work, but when your work is in progress and you want to show it to people, how do you vet readers, essentially? Like, who do you think would be good? Because you want somebody, obviously, who, like, trusts you as a storyteller and knows that, you know, you could sort of take them anywhere, but also, you know, will call you on your stuff if you, you know, if need be. I imagine, like, finding somebody with that balance could be pretty tough.
Yeah, no, it is very hard. And also, I think when you write longer stuff, it's hard to find people who are really excited to read your book every 2.5 years, so you mix it up. And I have friends who are good with nonfiction, or good with fiction, or some people good with structure, and so I know what I'm getting into with their critique. With Sag Harbor, it was a very personal book, and so each time I finished a chapter, I would show it to somebody, you know, who had read my earlier stuff, and I noticed that she was sort of taking time getting back to me, and I was like, oh, I'm freaking out, like, does she like it, not like it? And so one day I was like, so what do you think? And she's like, well, you know, I sort of like the Intuitionist more. And I was like, well, you know, it's me in the book, it's autobiographical. And she was like, yeah. And I was like, you know, we're married, right? And, she was like, yeah, that's what makes it so awkward. You have to, like, you know, find, if you know, the right person. With zone one, I didn't show anybody until I was totally done. I think I was, had a bunker mentality, and I was trying to maybe recreate some of the experience of some of the characters. They're on the run, can make it to the end. With the Underground Railroad book, I showed 100 pages to my editor and agent and wife, who's a literary agent, second wife. And they gave me comments, and I did another third, and they gave me comments, and now I'm giving it to them this week, and we'll see. So each book, I feel needy or less needy depending on how sure I feel about the work, and then you also have to take people in and out of rotation, because it is a huge thing, especially everyone's busy, to say, here's my 400-page unedited novel, get back to me in a week or else I'm going to freak out.
How did you get new people to read your work, or get people to read your work, period? And if they don't, how do you not take it personally?
Do you mean in terms of, like, attracting people to a new book or a promotion or, like?
Like, well, so I write a blog, right? And so when I post stuff up, I want feedback, but it seems like I see that people are reading it, but, like, nobody's giving me feedback. So how do you not take it personal, like, oh, nobody likes my stuff? And then how do you find, like, that intestinal fortitude to keep going even though you're not getting feedback?
Yes, no, it's incredibly difficult, and you have to get a thick skin, and also you have to find a clarity of purpose. And you're writing this blog because you have to, I assume. You have some sort of internal need to express yourself, and so you're going to do it whether you get one comment or 100 comments. And when you get one comment, you're going to have to suck it up and keep writing it, because that's what we do. It's terrible, and you just keep going, and it doesn't really get any better. I mean, I can go to Amazon and read, you know, Sag Harbor sucks. How come there's no white people in it? You know, I mean, people are not, you know, there's all, you know, people are going to hate your books for all, or your blogs for all sorts of reasons that are valid or not valid, and you have to get used to it. In terms of promoting my work as a writer, you know, I have a publisher and they have a whole apparatus of getting it out there. And then, you know, some books, you know, some take off and some don't. And you're like, that was a really good book. No one else really sort of thought so. And then you just, you know, keep going, you know, and I've been fortunate to have a, you know, a publisher who sort of believes in me when, you know, things don't go as well as they hope, or some things go better than they, you know, expected. And that's, all you can do is just write the best book you can, best blog you can, article, poem, short story, and hope people get it. And then 2 years from now, you're gonna look back at that blog post and like, that was kind of stupid. You know, I'm so much smarter and better now. And hopefully I'm growing as a writer. Hopefully anyone who is writing is getting better as they keep going, as they continue and fail and figure out how to do things differently. And then we all like to get recognition, but ultimately it really is just gonna be you and the computer, the notebook, picking yourself up after you finish something, you know. Sorry, I sound more cheerful.
Hope.
I have a question. It's a little bit of a twofold question.
Sure.
Well, first part, so after the Institutionist, it seems that a lot of people are calling you post-black author. So I was wondering, how would you position that book, since it seems like you're a chameleon of genre? So every book seems like it has a different sort of, like, I know authors don't like to like really categorize themselves, but if you had to. And also about the Institutionist, the protagonist was really concerned with finding this black box,
mm-hmm.
That was supposed to be the ideal elevator that would sort of uplift the race. And I was wondering what you envisioned that box was in 1991 and what you think it is 20 years after now that we have, you know, this very amazing room of black educators and we have a black president and there has been significant change. Do you think the black box has changed in form? Or, I don't know, what do you think it looks like?
Sure, yeah, no, those good questions. Here's a post-black, that seems to be more of like a 2006, 2009 coinage. It doesn't really mean anything to me personally. It's sort of like, you're only post-black when you actually stop saying post-black. Like the Neanderthals were like, I think we're really post-sabertooth now. They haven't really killed us in a while. Like if you're really post-sabertooth, you wouldn't mention it. Like we are post-sabertooth. It doesn't occur to us to say, sabertooths are gone and we don't have to deal with them anymore.
If you're free, you stop talking about freedom.
Sorry?
I said if you're free, you stop talking about freedom.
Yes, it's not you know, on your agenda. So. And I guess people define post-black in different ways. I mean, I've never felt a real affinity for the term. In terms of what the black box is, you know, it's, in the book, it's very open. It's what the reader thinks it is, really. Probably now, you know, I wrote that book in 96, and now it's almost, you know, so 19 years later. I didn't know what it is, what it was then. Probably, I'm sort of older, I have kids, I sort of want more things for the future now. I'm more invested in things working out than I was when I was just kind of broke guy writing in my apartment with no prospects. It's weird, I mean, I can't think what the black box meant for me then. I always think about like how I would change books now, if I was writing them now, and probably my earlier books would be more optimistic than they used to be. But then also, my new book and Zone 1 are pretty depressing, so that's not really true. So I'm not really sure how to answer, but thanks.
Okay.
So, well, thanks a lot, guys.
Yeah.
It was a lot of fun.
Absolutely. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah.